So today we're going to be looking at assessing writing, developing and assessing writing skills for B2 First for Schools. And just to introduce ourselves, I'm Sarah Ellis, and I'm in the assessment services team based in Italy.
And I am Alberto Costa. I'm also in the assessment services team, and I am speaking from Brazil.
So just before we start, we'd just like to mention a few housekeeping things. So we'd like to invite you to write your comments during the webinar as we invite you to participate in the chat. And if you have any particular questions that you hope we will answer, could you kindly write those in the Q&A? So if you write them in the Q&A, we'll try and answer as many questions as possible. We're also joined behind the scenes by our colleagues who will also be helping us making sure that we answer as many questions as possible. Just to let you know that after the webinar, you will be sent a recording, and you will also receive a certificate of attendance for taking part at this event. You will also be sent a link to the resources that are mentioned during the session, so you'll be able to refer to those after. So Alberto, is there anything else I've forgotten?
No, that's fine. I think it's time we start talking about the agenda for the day, Sarah.
Okay.
All right. So thank you everyone for joining from so many interesting parts of the world. Today we are going to talk about some of those things here. We're going to give you an overview of the B2 First for Schools paper 2, that is the writing paper. We are also going to give you some tips about preparing for writing, preparing our students for writing. So we're going to give you a brief look at process writing, that is the stages pre-writing, writing, revising, and editing.
Then we're going to move on to looking at ways to develop writing skills. And we're going to look at part one, particularly at the essay. And then we're going to be moving on to part two, and we've chosen to look at the article. We will also talk about ideas for exploiting the resources that you have in your course books as well. And throughout the session, we'll also be mentioning lots of other resources as well. And as we said, you will be receiving links to these resources after the session.
Okay, thank you, Sarah. So just to give you an overview of the B2 First for Schools writing paper, this is a very general outline of the paper. You know, it lasts 1 hour and 20 minutes. There are two questions or two texts that the students need to produce for this paper, right? One of the texts is an essay, that is a compulsory task. And for part two, there is a choice of texts that learners can choose. And we are going to talk about some of those text types in a moment, right? But before we continue, I'm going to ask you a question. How many words are candidates asked to write for both part one and part two in the B2 First for Schools writing paper? Can you mention that in the chat? We would like to see how much you know about this. Okay, very good. I can see lots of correct answers over here. Yes, well, the correct answer to this is learners need to write between 140 and 190 words for each of the writing tasks, right? Perhaps one of the questions that we get asked very frequently, Sarah, is what if the students write above 190 words?
Yes, now that's always a very important question to answer. And I think, of course, the number of words is a guide. And ideally, you will write within that range. And one of the things is that if students write more than those words, there is a little danger that they might not be relevant to the question. So that's also important. It's not just a number of words, it's also making sure that you're answering the question. And the danger is, as I said, if you write more than that, then you're likely possibly to be less relevant to the question. I think, would you agree with that, Alberto?
Yes, absolutely. So,
if you write fewer, then you might not have written enough to be able to answer the question. So that's another problem. So you've got the two extremes. So that obviously that's why there is a guide to the number of words. But it's very important that students don't spend time counting their words, but they spend the time making sure that they've checked the answer and that they've answered all the parts of the question.
Absolutely. So what you can see here is an overview of part one, the compulsory task, which is an essay, right? So when you look at this task for part one, you will see that learners will be given the essay title. So they need to focus on the title there. Also, they will be given two ideas to write about, and they need to add one idea of their own. This is really interesting because it gives the student, the candidate, the possibility to personalize the task a bit more, right? And they need to give an opinion and support the opinion with reasons. So this is why it should be written in paragraphs. And they have to write between 140 and 190 words. And they have about 40 minutes to complete this task. So 80 minutes in total for the writing paper for them to produce both part one and the text for part two.
Speaking about part two, I think it's quite important to draw the attention to the fact that we have a B2 first and B2 first for schools, because the paper in the writing paper is actually slightly different. So the tasks that you will find in part two for B2 first, for example, include a report. Usually students taking B2 first may be slightly older, and so a report is included here. Whereas in B2 First for Schools, which we can see on the left, we can see that there is a story is included and there is no report, but otherwise the tasks are similar. So they both have an article, they both have an email and a letter, both have the possibility of an essay and a review. But so watch out for that when you're looking at your dates of your exams as well, because if you take B2 First for Schools, you need to make sure that you're choosing that date, and then you will have these options in the writing paper. So that's just a thing to notice about the difference between the two versions of B2 first. Of course, the level is the same. Okay, so if the other thing to say, is like Alberta just said about part one, is of course we're writing again 140 to 190 words. But of course, students have a choice of what, and they only have to write one. So we can see a sample paper on the right. It's a little bit small to read the detail, but you can see that they actually have four options. In the standard B2 First, they only have three. So this is an advantage of their B2 First for Schools, is they actually have four options. And in this particular example, we can see a letter, a review, and a story. Now, I'd like to look at question five in more detail, because this is a special question for B2 First for Schools. So we can see in the next slide that we have an example of the part five. Can you click that, Alberto? Thank you. So we can see here that question five is always based on what we call a set text. So this in this particular example, the set text of that year was Macbeth. Now, obviously, these are texts that are chosen for readers at B2 level, so you're not reading the original version. And the question is related to that title. So in this case, write about an important relationship in Macbeth, and how does the relationship change? Now, what you'll see is we're not asking a literature question. This is about the content of the story. It helps students to, if you like, think about the topic before the exam. So many dyslexic students, for example, find it useful to be able to use this, but not only to use this question, because they can think about the topic before they actually take the exam. So talking about key scenes, talking about their own feelings about whether they've seen the film or whether they've seen the book. And this year, the book is Rebecca. So now you'll see in the MB that students should read the text, so read the book and watch the film. So again, it's very important that your students choose this question only if they have read the book and or watched the film. So if you like, you can do some reading and listening around the same topic. So that's this year. And just for your information, we thought it would be useful to show you the next set text from January 2023. So looking ahead is The Great Gatsby. So again, get your students to read the book and or watch the film so that they can prepare to answer this question.
Thank you, Sarah. Now we're going to talk about preparing students for writing. And I'm going to start by asking you a question. You know that some good writers, they have some strategies and skills. My question is, what do good writers do to write well? Can you share some thoughts in the chat, please? Yes, I can see lots of texts, lots of ideas. They plan their responses. Yes, they organize, they plan enough. They read, they tell good stories, they draft. Yes, so there are lots of ideas about how they organize their writing. They do brainstorming. Brainstorming is appearing quite a lot here. This is a very important word when we're talking about preparing for writing. Don't you agree, Sarah?
Yes, lots of things. Brainstorming, gosh, yeah. It's so fast, I can't read them all. Lots of practical ideas.
Absolutely. So when we are talking about preparing for writing, we are going to consider this approach to writing, which we call process writing. Basically, it's an approach to teaching writing that allows the teachers and the students to go through the process of producing a text together. So there is a lot of collaborative writing when we look at those phases. Well, in a nutshell, process writing is about having the pre-writing phase, which can include a number of activities such as brainstorming ideas, planning, organizing, selecting ideas. Pre-writing is a very important phase, and it's usually the kind of activities that we see mostly in course books. Then we have another phase when the students are actually producing a text, either on their own or producing a text in pairs or in groups, when they will be exchanging drafts with a peer, and then after that they reorganize ideas, they add, change information, they change words, they look at the language, and they also get feedback from the teacher at a given point. And then they do the final editing of their work, like checking punctuation and spelling or checking any grammar issues, that is proofreading the text, before they submit the final version to the teacher, or before this final version is published somewhere in the school platform, or maybe it's a writing competition or a writing project in the school where they will be displaying their texts, right? So publishing could mean different things in this sense here. So in a nutshell, this is the structure or the stages in process writing. And now what we're going to do is we're going to look at this essay task, which is part one for B2 First for Schools writing. So this is a typical task for part one. Here we have the title, like I mentioned. So teenagers are too young to teach each other about anything. They have some ideas, and learners need to add an idea of their own to add to the text. And it's important that we give them the opportunity to consider what ideas to include in the text. We know that if you ask or if you are asked to write a text immediately, you don't have the ideas right away. So it's important to give the students opportunity to come up with the ideas first. So one idea could be giving them a brainstorming activity where we look at the topics that are suggested, and then they add ideas to this topic in groups or in pairs. And then they add ideas to a second topic. Then they choose a topic of their own. And again, they can add more ideas to that topic. And then through this brainstorming, we are giving the students the possibility of considering a number of ideas that they will be discussing and selecting for their essay. And brainstorming, Sarah, can be done in many different ways, right? Sarah is going to share some ideas for online brainstorming.
Absolutely, and there are lots of digital tools that you can use, and I'm showing you some free ones that you can use. Poplet is the first, and you can see how obviously they can brainstorm around the main idea. Then we've got another example called Bubble, is that how you pronounce it? Bubble.us. And you can see again, you obviously can color the different ideas and space them around the main idea. And one of the advantages, of course, with digital tools is that it can help with organization because it can move them around more easily. And the last example we have is actually one of my favorite tools, which is Cobble. And Cobble, as you can see, has color, uses color as well. And this is a sort of mind map structure for a story. And you can see how we can choose different parts of the story, what won't happen, what could happen, so that the students can brainstorm their ideas before they get to the writing stage. No, absolutely. It's nice to use different tools. That's why I've got, you might find you prefer one or your students like a different one. So it's a good idea to try them out and see which works for you.
Thank you, Sarah. We are now going back to the task, typical task for part one. So we're going to start after we do the brainstorming with some more ideas to help students organize what to include in the text. So this is the task again. And then one of the things that we can do is to help the students to focus on certain points in the criteria for assessment. One of them is organization. And organization is always a very good starting point to help students become aware of how to structure their text. Here we have some top tips for you. For example, we understand that it's difficult to organize an essay clearly without making a simple plan. So the top tip here is organize a simple plan for the essay and decide what points to include in what order and how they are connected. That is, before they start writing their essay, they could come up with a simple framework, like the framework that we can see here. We can consider a certain number of paragraphs for this text. And then each paragraph, of course, will have a specific function that we can introduce to the students. For example, the introduction in paragraph one, they could start by giving their opinion. And then the last paragraph, when they summarize their ideas, and of course, they should use different words to provide a strong conclusion. And then in the paragraphs in the middle, they will be organizing their reasons to support their opinions, right? So the first reason, the second reason, the third reason. So we give the students a very simple outline of how to structure their text, and organization is a very good starting point. We can focus on language, right, Sarah?
That's right. I was just going to add to what you were saying, Alberta, that of course, in that paragraph structure that you've just shown, students often say, how much should I be writing? And one of the indicators that you can use is that roughly about three sentences per paragraph. But that's just an indication. It may be a way to help your students start having confidence for extending their writing. But as Alberta said, of course, the language that they're going to be using in the in their essay is obviously important. We can see that Alberta's mentioned the fact the students need to give reasons, they need to give opinions. So we need to, I think one of the ways we can do that is scaffold and help students be more aware of what language, what functions they can use in their essay. So I think we've got a table here, which shows some examples of those different functions. And the idea, of course, is that you get them to look at the phrases or look at the phrase and then put it into the correct group according to the function. So they're building up a kind of reference framework, which then they can use and they can make sure I need to add an idea, I need to contrast an idea, how can I do that? And they've got this very useful tool to help them with that. And this, by the way, is taken from a lesson plan. You will have the link to this that you'll be able to download and use. As you can see, it's here. So that's ready to go for you as teachers as well.
Yeah. Very good point, Sarah. Another idea is to give the students a sample text for them to read and also make sure that the text includes some of those points that we have been discussing. For example, Cambridge has points in the criteria for assessing writing, and those points include content, communicative achievement, organization, and language. So you can use a sample text and give the students the points in the criteria for them to analyze the sample text and see which parts are okay, which parts are positive, and which parts will probably need some improvement. So This is also part of the lesson plan that Sarah has just talked about. And one idea that we suggest is you can either use this task as it is with the table with the 4 points in the criteria, or you can just choose one of the points to start with and gradually get the students familiarized with the criteria. Our starting point as a suggestion is organization. Start from the organization point, and then gradually you can move to the other points as well, but it's a way of making the students aware of how to better structure the text, right?
Absolutely. And of course, as Alberto said, the idea of focusing, gradually introducing it, if you ask them to do all four immediately, obviously that feels like a big task. And it really helps them focus on one of the topics, especially at the beginning.
Yes, good point, Sarah. Here we have a page of a course book. This is Prepare Level 7, B2 First. This is the student's book. And when you look at the student's book, you will see that a number of pre-writing activities are present in the book. And this is just a way of highlighting them to you. So for example, the course book will probably bring some questions for students to discuss, as we can see in this example. They will also bring tasks that will lead the students to focus on the text type. So for example, they have to read the answer, the question here, and decide what question they have to answer. So there is a focus here on the text type. Also, they will bring ways of helping the students to organize their text. And this is connected with another activity, a follow-up activity, which is matching the paragraphs with the paragraphs in the sample text. So this gives the students already an idea of what to include. So we have a combination here of a product approach to process writing as part of the stages. And this is all, as we can see, good activities for the pre-writing phase, right? And then we have part two, right, Sarah?
Yes, absolutely. And I think just going back to what you said about the looking in the course book and seeing an example of the text type, it's really important, and especially for part two. So you've got different text types. So students need to be familiar. What does an article, what's different about the language in an article from an email? How do I recognize that it's an email? How do I see that it's a review? So looking at examples, of course, is an important part of the process. And I think we're going to focus on just one of the tasks, because I'm afraid we haven't got time to do all of them. So we've chosen to focus on the article and looking at the process of writing and getting ready to write. One of the problems for many students is that they don't have ideas about what to write. So this is where we come back to the framework that Alberto, I'll go back to you.
Yes. So this is just a recap of the framework where we have three phases. Then we have the pre-writing phase with a number of ideas, then the writing, revising, and editing phases, which is the moment when the learners are actually producing texts and revising the drafts before they submit the final version. And the purpose is to give the students the confidence to become better writers. Isn't that okay? Right, Sarah?
Yes, and I also think it's important for students to see that writing is actually quite messy. It's not like doing a grammar exercise where you can do it quickly, whereas you need to go through this process. It's normal to go through this process, and I think that's a very important aspect of becoming a better writing and developing your confidence that no, you can't get it right straight away. You do need to go through these different stages to get your piece of writing right. So we look at this question, Alberto.
Yes, so this is a typical part two kind of question. This is about writing an article. So the article, will, the question will bring a title, and then it will bring more information about the title. For example, life can be expensive, especially for teenagers. So the article is about telling us how you and your friends have fun without spending a lot of money, and the best article will be published in the Monks magazine. So the question will give this context that there is a competition, there is a title, a theme here, there is information about the theme, and of course, the number of words the students should produce for this text, right? And there are ideas that we can use.
Absolutely. And looking at the question, of course, Alberta's highlighted some of the features in the title. And of course, students, again, need to see, or and it's helpful for them to see that the question is actually designed to help them with their writing. If they read and look at the keywords, look at the things that they need to do, they're actually given some structure that helps them obviously create a good piece of writing. But let's go back to getting ready for that writing. And again, as we said, activating some ideas is really important. So using a discussion. So in this case, obviously, they're talking about what do you think life is expensive for teenagers or not? It's an activity which, of course, is speaking. Again, it's the integration of speaking into writing is also important. So an activity, you know, getting those ideas in spoken before we go into a written form is also useful. We've got questions, but we can also use pictures as a way of stimulating conversation, discussion, ideas for the topic. Obviously, those pictures have been chosen around the topic. And of course, we can use those questions to explore the topic a little bit further and extend and also start thinking about vocabulary related to that particular topic. And then we move on. Sorry, Alberto.
This is part of the lesson plan as well that we are going to share with you.
Absolutely, including the pictures too, which are copyright free. Then we can move on to extending the brainstorm, as Alberto said earlier. Brainstorming is a really important part of this process. So we've had a little bit of a discussion. Now we're going to get the students to think of at least three. So again, extending a little bit more, and then choosing the three that they would like to write about. So we're looking at reorganizing and again, planning around our ideas, which is so useful.
Yeah, and Sarah mentioned highlighting some keywords in the question, right, Sarah? So to help students understand what they need to focus on. One of the things you can do is to think about questions the students need to answer about the item, the exam item itself. So for example, they look at the question and then they have to answer something such as, what kind of text should you write? Who will the readers be? So making sure that they have the target reader in mind, and that will impact the kind of language they will be using, whether it is formal or informal, and how they're going to structure their text and the style as well. So questions which will focus on the text type as well, not only about the content. So this will give the students insights about how to organize what they're going to write. And one of the things we can do as well is to focus on language. We are talking about writing an article, so making sure that students demonstrate that they have a range of vocabulary is really important. So here is one language-focused activity that you can bring to students, which is adjectives, making sure they vary the language they use. And this task in particular focuses on the opposite meaning of the words in bold that you can see on the left. So let's do only one together. If you look at the word number one here, good, what's the opposite of this word when you look at the first line? So let's look at the chat and see. Okay, very good. We are looking at awful as the answer. That's very difficult, isn't it, Sarah? So here, I'm going to give you the key because we don't have time to go from one line to the other. But this is just an idea of a language-focused activity to highlight to students that they should show a range of language when they are writing an article, for example.
And of course, you can extend it by getting them to find the opposites of the other words that are not there.
Yes,
the key.
Absolutely. And Sarah, you're going to mention some tips as well.
Absolutely. So some particular feature of an article is actually the title. So there are some tips here in this, again, this is from the lesson plan, about the way to structure an article. So we talked about structuring an essay. Again, with the essay, you have an introduction and a conclusion. Again, we're going to need the same thing, an introduction. And what's different is that we're looking at two or three body paragraphs this time. So that will depend on obviously what the student is choosing to write about. And then in the exam, and again, top tip, And I noticed that some people are writing it in the chat, so thank you for that. The emphasis on getting your students to spend that time before they write to actually think. They're not wasting time, they're thinking. It will make the writing flow better because they've already begun to organize their thoughts. So 5 to 10 minutes is recommended on thinking about what they're going to write in that article in this particular case before they actually start writing. And then thinking about the title, so here's an example of the content that we might have in our article. So we've got our introduction with some content about that. I think that's going to come up in a minute. Yep. So we've got some ideas, and obviously there are three ideas, and we'll talk about that in a moment. Some information for the body paragraphs. And of course, as we said, paragraph 3 is optional. And then, of course, a conclusion. Now, here comes the top tip. It's really to make the article even more interesting, of course, is to have a title that grabs the attention of the reader, that makes the reader think, yes, I want to read this article. Now, a student might think, oh, that sounds, you know, how do I do that? Well, these are some tips on how to write an interesting title that you can obviously give your students. So we've got the first paragraph of two articles with the title in each case, and let's see some of the strategies that are being used here. So some of the strategies that you can use in an article are these on the right. Now, they're obviously not in the right order, and you would need to match them with the article. Now, to save time, that's in the lesson plan, but to save time for this session, we've broken it down and we'll take you through it. So we can see that sun, sea and sand. And we have the mention of three ideas in the second article, is this power of three. So think of things in threes is a good way to make statements more memorable and titles more memorable. So that's one strategy, is think in threes. And then we have, of course, you will have heard me say, I just have to think about it, sun, sea and sand. Best beach, you know, exams easy. Of course, we got examples of alliteration. So often titles will use alliteration to make them more appealing. So again, you can think about examples of that. Other things are in an article is to grab the attention, is also to state a problem. So here we have, there are many great beach holidays on offer. It can be difficult to choose. So read the article to find out. So the article is going to offer the solution. So we can see that's another technique. And a further technique is, again, if we look at this particular title, how to pass exams the easy way. So using a question word like how in the title, how to, why to, is what, you know, what to do, etc., can again be make the article more attractive and more interesting. So again, good tip. And last but not least of the strategies is in the article is actually to involve the reader by asking them a question. So in this particular question about exams, are you good at preparing for exams? So the reader is thinking of their answer as they go further into the article. So these strategies, and this is in the lesson plan, you can show your students how these work and they can obviously try that out for themselves. Because I think it's really important that students have some tools to work with. It's not, you know, it's not automatic that they know how to write an article, what features of an article. So they really need to break it down. I think that really helps.
Yes. Thanks, Sarah. And when you ask a question, you involve the reader immediately. This is how I feel when I read articles as well. When there is a question, I feel more interested. So again, we have here a sample page of a course book called Open World First Level B2. And when we look at the book, we can see that there are many interesting pre-writing activities that we can do with the students. And it's important to highlight. So Open World, for example, will bring a true or false task for learners to decide which statement applies to writing an article. I think this is an interesting way of focusing on the text type. You also have, for example, an activity focusing on the exam question, and then they have to underline the keywords or the questions that they have to answer. So This goes back to your point, Sarah, looking at the question and highlighting things to focus on, right? And we also have, for example, questions that will get the students to do, you know, a quick brainstorming. So make notes using questions, tell your partner about your ideas. And of course, an item here that an exercise that helps the students to organize their plan. And before that, they see two sample writing plans and they decide which one is the best plan and why. So this already indicates to learners how they can best structure their ideas for writing. And then we have the other phase, right, Sarah? Writing, yes. Revising and editing.
Yes, there's a lot to do here. And of course, finding that time to do the writing is important. And I think you've got some tips here, Alberto, about that.
Yes. I was going to say that many pre-writing activities are easily seen in course books, but some things that we are less likely to see are the activities for the actual text production. So the moment when the learners are actually writing the text. So we're going to focus now on activities for writing, revising, and editing. So for example, it's important that they write the body and concluding paragraphs. And when they write their article, they should try to use the vocabulary from a language-focused activity. So just to remind you, we showed a sample activity on language focus. This was on opposites of adjectives. And they should also, throughout the process of writing, revising, and editing, make use of a simple checklist or a success criteria, you know, something that they can use to assess their work. And we have something very nice to share with you, which is the B2 First Writing Checklist. And this is one part of the checklist which focuses on the criteria for assessing writing. So learners will be able to look at the 4 points in the criteria and look at what they should consider as positives and what they should see as things to avoid when they are writing a text. So it's very important that they have access to this and this becomes clear. Again, there's a lot of information here. So I was going to say, start from one of the points and our suggestion is start from the organization point in the criteria, because this is where students will benefit most, we feel.
And one of the things I like about this checklist, to add to already what Albert has said, is the fact that it shows language actually is the fourth criteria, because often students are really worried about their grammar and vocabulary, so they're not thinking about the importance of the content, the importance of, you know, are they communicating with the reader, you know, have they organized all these things that they can improve, and it's not just about grammar and vocabulary. So that's what's a really useful thing about these checklists, is it gets the students to move away from that perhaps mindset that I need to worry just about my grammar. And I think we can see on the next slide how you, there's a slightly more detailed version of that too. So
yes, so just to recap on the points for process writing, when we look at those two phases, writing, revising, and editing, there are many things that can be done with learners in the classroom. Just as a recap again, they can exchange draft with their peers and then they reorganize their ideas. They add, change, or remove parts, and you could be using a checklist for them to be able to do those things together. They could be focusing on language by changing words or expressions and then checking punctuation, spelling, any grammar issues. And then they will be getting feedback from the teacher before they are ready to submit the final version of their text. You will notice that when we look at those two phases here, there's a lot of formative assessment taking place. So learners are given the opportunity to produce something and then they do self-assessment or peer assessment. So there is assessment for learning in this case. And then they get feedback from the teacher. They will be given another opportunity to revise the text. And then they submit a final version. So it's important to show that process writing allows for a lot of formative assessment while learners are producing their text. And I think this is really reassuring for learners, isn't it, Sarah?
Absolutely.
And we can also use a more detailed criteria, right, Sarah?
That's exactly. So following up on from what you were saying earlier about the first checklist that you showed, this is a more detailed version where we can see there are questions for the students to be thinking about for each topic. So if we look at the content, we can see that they need to think about those three questions. So, and if it becomes automatic, they think content, okay, key information, relevant, you know, have I developed it as well? So again, thinking about that. And then of course, looking at the communicative achievement, are they thinking about the functions? It's, you know, if it says I need to give my reasons or give my opinion, have I included that? And of course, as we see, as they go through it, is it complex and straightforward ideas as well? It will obviously influence the reader. And then we have the other two criteria, the big one that we've been speaking about, very important focus is looking at the organization. And again, we have some very clear questions, thinking about paragraphs. In some nationalities, paragraphing is not automatic. So it's really important to think about paragraphing, looking at other organizational features, that beginning, that conclusion, in the case of the article that we were talking about, as well as how they're linking. So a nice checklist for the students to be able to see what makes the piece of writing successful. If they've done these things, then the writing is more likely to be successful. And then we have the last one, last part of the checklist, looking at language. Of course, it's important to think about languages too, and vocabulary, as Alberto's been saying, making sure that they're extending their range of vocabulary, especially at B2, it's that range which becomes more important as we go up the levels, and of course, and not repeating themselves, not that unnecessarily, and checking that they're perhaps they're using phrasal verbs or other phrases as well as simple grammatical phrases. And the last one, of course, is checking that spelling. A lot of students don't bother to check their spelling. And so, of course, that's a pity because, of course, it's something easy for them to do to make sure that they've got time, they've checked their spelling, thought about that kind of things as well. As well, of course, as their grammar, as we said before.
Yeah. And Sarah, this checklist will be available as well for you to access and download and share it with your learners, by all means.
Okay, and also as we think about strategies for learners, this is a very simple strategy, and again we'll give you the reference to it, power writing. Already it sounds very exciting in the sense of it's a positive outcome. So P, obviously it's an acronym, and each letter stands for something. So we have P standing for prepare. Could also, that includes plan, making sure you've done some research, so you've got some content. And then obviously brainstorming and narrowing down your ideas. Then we have O to stand for the organization. So you've got some content. Now, how are you going to organize that into your essay, into your article, and thinking about the paragraphs? W, of course, you need to write it. So you write your answer, having done the first two stages. Then, of course, we've got E for edit. So again, encouraging this practice that students go back and look and correct any unnecessary repetition, for example, check their spelling. And then, of course, last but not least, we review and reflect. Now, in the course with the exam situation, it's a good idea if students also get maybe a peer to check or their teacher to check, and think about how they can improve to make it better for next time. So this is all about being looking at positive solutions to creating more confident writers. Yes. So power writing.
Yes, and one of the things that it's important to encourage in learners is independence in writing. So helping the learners to know how to structure the text, get feedback, revise, and become more independent writers. We have something to share with you, which is this platform called Write and Improve. Write and Improve has a number of free tasks for learners to access, read, write their answers, submit, and get immediate feedback on areas to work on and improve, so they can do the editing work and submit it again and get more feedback and so on and so forth. So they can choose the level and then Within each level, there are many activities for them to practice, and they are interested in writing tasks which resemble exam tasks. But WriteImprove has an area called Test Zone, and Test Zone is a paid for area, but for the B2 first exam, there are some free samples for learners to practice their writing at level B2. So you can see here that when you go to Test Zone, choose the exam B2 first, and they will access 5 sets of B2 first questions for free. So each of the sets will bring part 1 and part 2 with 3 different tasks. So in total, they'll be able to practice with 20 different B2 first tasks. So this is an example of part 1 here in WriteImprove. And then part 2, you have question 2, question 3, question 4 to choose from. And for each question, they'll be able to write, submit, and get feedback. So altogether, they have 20 free tasks to practice writing at level B2. And we highly recommend that students practice using this platform and become more independent.
One thing about the platform is that there is a timer, so they can choose to do it under time. So if you just go back to the slide before, we can just show where it is. You can see at the bottom of the task, it says that you can start the timer. So that's good. Some people were making comments in the chat about the importance of time management. And Alberto said at the beginning that it's important that they give equal time to both questions. And so again, within this app, you can actually practice writing with timed writing, which I think, of course, is very important that students have that experience before they get to the exam. And then we go on to some other resources, I think.
Yes, Sarah, we have a few other resources, right?
Absolutely. And one of them is in this top tips booklet, teaching tips. And the reason we particularly wanted to point it out is it has some top tips for set text. So looking at that question 5, some ideas about preparation for that, because question 5, as I said, is the set text, but the text types will be the same as the other 3 options that they have. So just to really emphasize that. So you'll find tips on different skills in this teaching tips booklet. So speaking, reading and writing, but obviously we're referring you to the writing section for today. There is also another guide, which we really would like to highlight. And this is this amazing assessing writing guide for a B2 first and first for schools, obviously. This guide gives you lots of information on writing and assessing writing. There are lots of examples of students writing with marks and comments, which are really helpful for the teacher. So we can see that on the next slide, I think. You can see an example of a student's piece of writing. This is focusing on communicative achievement criteria. So again, that idea of focusing one criteria. And we can see on the left of the slide how that criteria, and there are what does it mean? So for the teacher to really understand what each criteria is all about, you can see how clearly it takes you through that. And then on the right, we have the sample piece of writing, and we have some highlighted language. In this case, the green is highlighting straightforward language and yellow is highlighting complex. And again, when you're thinking about your students' writing, you might be doing that too, using the idea of highlighting straightforward language or complex language. And you can see that again in the guide, there are some examiner comments, the kind of things that are really useful for teachers to read, and obviously the mark that this would be awarded, which again is very useful.
Yes, we talked a lot about, along with the writing strategies, the focus on language for learners. And one of the things at level B2 that learners need to show is range of vocabulary. So Cambridge has made those posters available, and each poster focuses on a theme. So we have the themes of technology, environment, and entertainment. And each poster comes together with a booklet of lesson plans and classroom activities, which are really, really useful. And they also help you to practice all the different skills with the learners. So just to give you an example, this is a task that focuses on the use of phrasal verbs. So this example here shows phrasal verbs related to the area of entertainment. So together with the lists of phrasal verbs, you will find activities such as this one, where learners need to read the questions and decide which phrasal verbs will go in each of the questions here. And afterwards, they can use those questions, you know, to interview each other and to practice speaking, discussing ways of, you know, entertaining themselves. So phrasal verbs are really important at level B2, and each of the posters will bring sets of phrasal verbs for you to practice with your learners, along with other activities to practice different skills as well, writing, reading, listening, etc. So this is a very interesting one. And of course, we talked about the, giving the students a writing checklist, but the handbook for teachers will also bring the rubrics or those assessment scales for you to give feedback on students' writing. So this is the typical Cambridge assessment criteria for B2 First for Schools, which focuses on the points like, such as content, communicative achievement, organization, and language. And you'll be able to access the assessment scales from the handbooks for teachers, apart from a number of other pieces of information that the handbook will provide. And as a summary, Sarah, we covered quite a lot today, didn't we?
We did, yes. There's a lot to know about B2 First writing.
Yes. We talked about B2 First, the writing paper, in detail. We talked about process writing and the stages, pre-writing, writing, revising, and editing.
And we talked a little bit about developing writing skills, particularly for part one and the compulsory essay. So some practical activities. And also we've looked at part two. We've talked about the range of tasks that students can choose. And we focused on the article in particular, again, with some ideas for the classroom and particularly a lesson plan for you to take away. Yes. We focused on exploiting course book resources. Alberto spoke about that. And we also spoke about resources. And in fact, on the next few slides, you'll be able to see a summary. Perhaps you'd like to talk about that, Alberto.
Yes, so you will be given those useful links for you to download the lesson plans, the writing checklist, access the power writing points that Sarah mentioned, the Write and Improve platform, as well as the teaching tips for B2 First for Schools and the guide for assessing writing, as well as the posters and the handbook for teachers. So all of those links will be made available to you very shortly, very soon. And now I think it's the time for questions. But while you are asking us questions, we haven't finished yet. I would like to highlight that you can access our website, and when you go to the exams and tests tab, you'll be able to access B2 First for Schools. And there is an area called preparation. When you click on the preparation tab, you'll be able to access many resources related to B2 First for Schools, including the mock tests, the sample tests, and the key to the sample test, the handbook, and many of the things we have talked about. So for now, time for questions, right?
Okay, let's have a look in the Q&A questions. There are several questions, Alberto, about whether students have to write a title when they're in part two. Do they have to write a title for the essay? Do they have to write a title in part two?
Yeah, they have to write a title for the article. So this is really important. So when they are writing an article, they need to include a title.
And not for the essay.
Not for the essay, yes.
Let's have a look. Can you see them too? Yeah.
There is a question here about students, for example, if students take time writing, and they may take long, and some students may finish quickly. I think it's a good idea to consider timing the students, but in the classroom, make sure that you follow the stages that we talked about, process writing, and gradually give the students the confidence to produce a text within the specific time frame. So first, make sure that you give them the opportunity to generate ideas, organize their ideas in a plan, and then time them when they are producing their texts.
Absolutely. That's very sensible.
Yeah.
Okay. Good strategies to teach students about how to manage there. I think we're just to emphasize what you just said, Alberto, is obviously the more familiar they are with it, the better. And writing the improve allows students to get used to writing under timed conditions. And I think that's important to actually practice it, because the more they practice it, the more they'll be used to using the time well for their planning stage, the writing stage, and the editing stage.
Yes, there is a question here about the impact of teaching writing to the exam, whether or not it limits students' creativity. I think it's important to consider that the exam is a moment for students to demonstrate that they have the skills to write different types of texts within a specific time frame. And I think rather than limiting, it actually helps the students to widen their scope of ideas to include in the text if we give them the opportunity to do the brainstorming before and then organize the ideas from the brainstorming in a plan, and then they'll be able to make decisions together with their peers about what to include, what to leave out, and then structure the text. I mean, every text that we write in real life has a certain pattern, has a structure, and that's what we are providing the students with. They just need to make sure they manage their creativity and organize their points within the text type.
There's some questions about spelling, which are very interesting, and how can students check their spelling? Well, of course, one of the things to remind them is that, of course, they won't be able to use spell check, even if they're doing the computer-based version of B2 First for Schools. So one of the things that they can do, of course, is during their, while they're studying in preparation, is make a note of their typical spelling mistakes. It's things like, you know, even as a native speaker, I could never spell environment. So I had to, for example, I had to make sure that I was checking particular words that I knew I was in danger of not spelling correctly. So my noticing your errors as you and how it should be correctly spelt may be one of the ways that they help be more confident about the spelling.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Okay, are students provided with the extra paper for planning? Now, of course, this will depend on the exam centre to provide the paper. And they can also write on the question paper. There are some spaces and blank spaces on the question paper that they can use for planning. And one tip for that is that when they've done the plan, they should, you know, cross it out to show that it's obviously not part of their answer for the And the other tip that I always say is that your writing needs to be clear, not beautiful. So sometimes students spend so much time doing a rough copy that they don't leave them time to transfer it onto the answer sheet. So the recommendation is to use that time for planning and not necessarily doing a full rough copy so that they don't find themselves without time to finish their writing. I don't know if you have any ideas about that, Alberto.
Yes, that's right. There is a question here, Sarah, which is about the assessment criteria, whether it is the same for both B2 First and B2 First for Schools. It's the same criteria, right?
Absolutely. And mm-hmm. that all four are equally important. That's why the emphasis on grammar, for example, is only part of the story. So they do need to fulfill the other criteria as well.
Yes, and one interesting question about how to help students to improve their vocabulary. I would say start by using the posters, because the posters are really rich in terms of vocabulary, and they will bring interesting ideas, not only to learn, but also to practice the vocabulary, especially phrasal verbs for level B2. So that would be a good starting point. And of course, anything that is vocabulary related has to do with exposure to language. So give them different ways of using the language, listening to the language, short reading, video clips, reading materials, etc. Many things that they can do to, you know, be exposed to language and then improve vocabulary, right?
Well, I think, thank you, Alberto. I think we've actually run out of time. So thank you very much for all of your questions. I'm sorry we haven't been able to answer all of them. We hope you found the session useful. As we said, you will be sent a certificate of attendance after the session and the recording, and you will also be given the links to the resources that have been mentioned throughout the session. I just want to say thank you to Alberto. I enjoy this journey with you, and thank you. And thank you to everyone for joining us today.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sarah, for joining me in this webinar, the preparation, the organization of ideas and curation of activities and all. And thank you, everyone, for attending the webinar. It's been a pleasure.
And thank you to Kate and Nadia, who have been helping in the chat, and our colleagues from the UK. So thank you for your support. So thank you, everyone, and we look forward to seeing you at the next webinar.
Yeah, thank you.